Section 16 of The Golden Web by E. Phillips Oppenheim. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Book 1, Chapter 16, A Reprieve. Morning dawned upon a land still as though from exhaustion. The long waves, sole remnant of the storm, came gliding in with a slow, lazy motion and broke noiselessly upon the firm sands. The sky was blue. Of wind there was none at all. Inland, the flood tide was still high. Only the tops of the dikes were visible. Everywhere the sea had found its way into unexpected places. Little patches of the marshes, from which it had just receded, shone with a new glory, a green glitter like the sparkle of emeralds. Deane, who was out early, for his bed had been no more than a sofa, gave a little start of surprise as he opened the door and found Winifred Rowan standing on a little knoll by the side of the flagstaff, looking seaward. She turned towards him at once, with the sound of the opening door. He realized then, more completely than in the dusk of the evening, how great the strain of these last few days had been, the strain which had driven her into this strange journey. The black rings under her eyes seemed as though traced with a pencil. Her cheeks were thinner. There was something pathetic about the quick, startled look which flashed into her eyes at the sound of Deane's approaching footsteps. "I'm afraid," he said gravely, "that you have not slept." "As much as usual," she answered. "Tell me, what time do your letters come?" He looked inland. "Generally about 8. They may be a little later today." She nodded. "I must go back," she said vacantly. "When is there a train?" It was impossible to ask her to stop, and yet he felt all the pathos of sending her back to face alone the shadow of her terrible anxiety. "There is no hurry," he said. "We will look out the trains after breakfast." "Are you going to stay here?" she asked anxiously. "If I thought," he answered, "that there was the slightest thing I could do in London, which I have not already done, I would go back by the first train this morning. But indeed you must remember what I told you last night. The matter is practically settled. In a few days he will know." "It is those few days," she said softly, "which are so terrible." It was hard to try and make use of any conventional phrase of reassurance. Deane, remembering how intense, how real and startling a thing this tragedy really was, found it hard, impossible indeed. "Tell me," he asked, "do you live absolutely alone?" "Yes," she told him. "There was a cousin who was with me for some time, but she got a situation on the other side of London and had to move. I was in a boarding house," she continued, after a moment's hesitation, "until this happened. Then all the people, well, they meant to be kind," she broke off, "but the woman who kept it thought I had better leave, and I suppose she was right." "We will go into breakfast," he said, a little abruptly. Every moment he seemed to realize more completely the pathos of her position. They turned towards the house. Suddenly, her fingers fell upon his arm. "Who is that?" she asked, pointing landwards. Deane followed her outstretched finger. Riding along the top of one of the dikes, as though unconscious of the sea flowing on either side, came a boy on a bicycle. The bicycle was painted red, and the boy had on a cap whose high peak gave it a semi-official look. "He is coming here," said Deane. "It may be my letters, or I think—" He stopped short. He knew very well that it was a telegram the boy was bringing, but he almost feared to say anything which would bring hope into her face. "It isn't. It couldn't be a telegram," she asked a little wistfully. "It might be," he admitted. "I get a good many, of course." He told the lie unblushingly. All the time he watched, with an anxiety which seemed incredible, for the coming of the messenger. "You must remember," he said, "that even if this should be a telegram, I really do not expect any news yet." She said nothing. She stood with parted lips by his side, and they watched the boy drive his bicycle along the sea-stained bank. Once he skidded, and she gave a little scream. Deane laughed at her, surprised to discover something unnatural in the sound. "Well," he said, "we will meet the boy here. I'm afraid you will find a few stock exchange quotations inside the envelope, even if he should be—" "It is the telegraph boy," she interrupted. "I can see the wallet. She clung to his arm. Deane found himself patting her fragile hand with his strong fingers. He drew her arm through his and led her a few steps further forward. The boy jumped off his bicycle and opened his wallet as he approached with a familiar movement. Deane took the telegram into his fingers and tore it open. His arm suddenly went round her waist. "Miss Rowan," he said, "be brave, and I will tell you some good news. See, you can read it for yourself. The reprieve is signed." She suddenly fell a dead weight upon his arm, and almost as quickly she recovered herself. Her closed eyes were open. She clung to him passionately. "Is it true?" she cried out. He held the telegram in front of her face. "Read," he said. "Reprieve signed last night. Will be communicated to Rowan this morning. Hardaway. That is the name of my solicitor. So there is no possible doubt about it. The matter is ended." He turned to the boy, who stood looking on with a wooden face. Then he drew a coin from his pocket. "My young friend," he said, "you are in luck. Take that and go home to your breakfast." The boy looked at the sovereign and up at Deane. So far as his features were capable of expression at all, they spoke of stupefaction. Then, as though afraid that Deane might change his mind, he mounted his bicycle and rode rapidly away. "It is a relief to you, of course," Deane said, trying to speak in as matter-of-fact a tone as possible. "But this thing was a certainty all the time. I've always tried to make you believe that. Come in now, and let us have some breakfast. You ought to have an appetite." She followed him without a word. She seemed, indeed, like a person dreaming, not wholly able to realize the things happening around her, even the moments that passed. Deane waited upon her at breakfast and talked in a matter-of-fact way, accepting her monosyllabic answers as natural things, carrying on a conversation, too, with the man who waited at the sideboard. By degrees, a more natural expression came into her face. When at last the meal was over and the servant had left the room, she burst suddenly into tears. Deane took her outside and placed her in a chair, sitting by her side on the sands. "Now," he said, "that is all over." "When can I go back?" she asked suddenly. "They will let me see Basil. I must go and tell him." "He knows, of course," Deane replied, "but naturally he will want to see you. You can leave here in about an hour. I am not sure. Perhaps I may come with you." She sat there quietly, absolutely content to lie still and gaze out at the sea. Presently Grant came out with a note, which Deane silently opened. It was dated from the cottage, Ranke. "Dear Mr. Deane, my niece knows, and she insists upon going to London at once. We are all very much disturbed. If it is not troubling you too much when you are passing this way, we should be so grateful if you would call in for a minute." Deane looked thoughtfully seaward, and his face hardened as he crumpled the note up in his hand. Then he rose to his feet. "I am going in to see about the trains for you," he said. He hired a cart from the village, and they stood together on the platform of the nearest railway station an hour or so later. She laid her arm upon his sleeve. "Will you stop for a moment, please?" she said. "I'm afraid I must have seemed ungracious. After all, I ought to be very grateful to you." He shook his head. "No," he answered. "It is always I who must be your debtor. I ought to have been firmer with your brother when I sent him to this man, Sinclair, to make terms. It was a desperate enterprise, after all, and I ought to have realized the danger of your brother being tempted to use violence. To me, he was nothing more than a unit of humanity, and I took him at his word. If he had brought me the paper I wanted, I was quite prepared to ask him no questions whatever, and he would have been a rich man. I can't help feeling that in a sense I am responsible for his present position and yours." She looked away from him. Her eyes were fixed upon the horizon. She appeared to be steadily thinking the matter out. The wind blew little wisps of fair hair over her face. Her eyes were steadfast, her forehead a little wrinkled. She seemed to be endeavoring to arrive at a conscientious decision. "No," she said after some time, "I cannot see that you are to blame. I am sure that it never entered into your head that my brother might be tempted to use violence." Deane looked away with a little frown. In his heart he knew very well that he was not so sure. "Well," he said, "we will let that go. At any rate, my responsibility to you remains. Tell me what I can do. How can I help you?" She shook her head. "I am going back to my work," she said. "I need no help."
"Your work?" he repeated.
She nodded with a little sigh. "I am a typist," she said. "You know what that means. Genteel starvation, long hours, gray days. Never mind, I am almost used to it." "You need be a typist no longer unless you choose," he said. "Part of what I promised to your brother belongs to you." She shook her head. "Don't speak of it," she exclaimed. "I should feel that it was blood money."
"At least let me hear from you sometimes," he said. "Don't let me lose sight of you altogether while your brother is unable to help you."
She hesitated. Then lifting her eyes to his, "I don't believe," she said softly, "that you would tell me anything that was not true."
"I don't believe that I should," he answered.
"Then tell me this," she said, "honestly. When you made my brother that offer, when you sent him to deal with this man Sinclair, can you tell me that you had not an idea in your mind that he might be led on to do something rash?"
Deane hesitated. He was not a man of overstrict scruples, but he hated lies. Somehow or other it seemed to him impossible to look at this girl and tell her anything that was not the truth.
"I am not altogether sure," he answered. "At the back of my head there was just the idea that your brother was desperate, that he would gain what he wanted somehow or other."
She turned away and walked a little way down the platform. The train was already in the station. She entered a carriage and sat in the furthest corner.
"Thank you," she said. "I'm glad that you have told me the truth. Would you mind going away now, please?"
"I'm sorry," Deane said simply. "Remember that I only did what 99 men out of 100 would have done in my place. I wanted that paper, and your brother begged for just such an enterprise."
She held out her hands. "If you please," she said, "goodbye."
Deane turned away. The girl was a little fool, of course, yet, as he turned and watched the smoke of the train disappear, and thought of her in her empty third-class carriage, alone, he was conscious of a sense of acute depression, none the less acute because it was vague. He turned back to the village, walking with heavy steps. It was as though a new trouble had come into his life. End of chapter 16.